Welcome here at Grace Lutheran Church in Tananda, where our Lord Himself gathers us, invites us to be among us and to bless us. So I pray that today He would bless you richly with His Word and with His Spirit. Let us begin. Fight the good fight of the faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called, and about which you made the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. Friends in Christ, let us confess our sins to God, our Father, and ask Him, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, to forgive us. Lord God, our Heavenly Father, I am a sinner, and I have sinned against you, not only in my words and actions, but also in my secret thoughts and desires, which I cannot fully know or understand, but which you know completely. I am sorry that I have displeased you, and repent of the evil I have done, for the sake of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Have mercy on me, forgive my sins, and graciously help me in my weakness.
Amen.
Amen. Dear brothers and sisters, upon this your confession and prayer, I, as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God to all of you. And on behalf of my Lord Jesus Christ and by His command, I forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, peace be with you.
Amen.
Amen. Now let us speak to our Lord with the words He Himself has given, with the words of Psalm 46. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore we will not fear, though the earth gives way, though the mountains be moved into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble at its swelling. There is a river whose stream may glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God will help her when morning dawns. The nations range, the kingdoms stutter. He utters His voice, the earth melts. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Come, behold the works of the Lord, how He has brought desolation on the earth. He makes war cease to the end of the earth. He break the bow and shatter the spear. He burned the chariot with fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Glory to the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever.
Amen.
Amen. And the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Lord God, you have prepared for those who love you good things beyond our understanding. Pour into our hearts such love for you, that we may love you in all things and above all things, and obtain what you have promised, which is more than we can desire. We ask this through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. And reading from the Holy Scriptures for today comes from Paul's first letter to Timothy, chapter 6, verses 11 to 16. Pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, steadfastness, gentleness. Fight the good fight of the faith. Fight the good fight of the faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called and about which you made the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. I charge you in the presence of God, who gives life to all things, and of Christ Jesus, who in his testimony before Pontius Pilate made a good confession, to keep the commandment unstained and free from reproach until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he will display at the proper time. He, who is a blessed and only sovereign, the King of kings and Lord of lords, who alone has immortality, who dwells in unapproachable light, whom no one has ever seen or can see, to him be honor and eternal dominion. Amen. And this is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And let us confess our Christian faith together with the church at all times and in all places.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen.
Let us sing to the Lord.
Spread the rain of
peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we have received encouragement through your faithful servant, Apostle Paul, So Heavenly Father, we bless that this evening, we pray that this evening you would bless us with your Spirit, would help to understand well what Paul's message to us is, and that you would fill us with your Spirit and with joy, hearing the good news of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. In our today's reading, Paul speaks about faith, about the importance of keeping and guarding our faith, and even fighting the good fight for our faith. And to appreciate what Paul says, we need to be clear. We need to understand, why is our faith such a big deal? I would like to tell you a story. There is this king, and he is not like other kings, not at all. He is, as Paul puts it, the only sovereign, the King of kings, the Lord of lords, immortal, and dwelling in an approachable light. And his kingdom is not like other kingdoms. In the middle, there is this great city of the king, with a tree of life and the river of the water of life flowing through it. And there is no oppression, no injustice, no lies, no evil. Everything there is good. Very, very good. However, for now, there is something that overshadows the otherwise pure blessedness of his kingdom. One of his subjects have led a riot against this king. And as a result, his favorite beloved creatures are held captives by the enemy. And the enemy has filled their hearts and their ears with his lies, portraying this King of Kings as some selfish and judgmental tyrant. He has stolen their hearts, their love for their creator, for their king, has grown cold. For some, it has turned into hatred. And the king could, of course, just bring them back by force. But that is not an option for true love. He wants their hearts, not their submission. He wants them to come home freely and willingly, not forced. And he knew that there is only one force powerful enough to overcome the lies of the enemy and to silence every hatred and to regain the hearts of his favorite creatures. And this force is pure, selfless love. So out of his holy love, the King of Kings went through great suffering and by giving up his own life and embracing death, he created a way through which his children could pass from their captivity into his kingdom. And he prepared the seal of the Spirit for those who wanted to return. And only those with the seal would be allowed into the great city of the king. Meanwhile, his children live under the rule of the king's enemies. And even if the sun is shining, that is still dark and gloomy world, filled with lies and selfishness, with strife and injustice, with evil and fear and loss, ending in death without a hope. But because the children of the king have not seen anything else, they don't even realize how bad it is. And for King of Kings, it is heartbreaking to see his beloved in such captivity. So he launched this rescue mission and sent out his messengers. And they were to tell his children the truth about who they truly are. Dearly loved children of the great and gracious king, held captives by his enemies. And to tell them about everything that the king has done for them out of his great love. and how much he longs to be again reunited with him, together with them. So they were sealed, the children with the seal of the Spirit that would grant their return to the kingdom of their Father. And then, what a life it would be. Whatever bad we see in this world, pain and loss and sin and sickness, temptations, injustice, death, they all will be gone. Yes, even death will be no more. And whatever good is in this world, it will be multiplied infinitely. Joys and beauty and love and friendships, pleasure and peace and adventures and discoveries, truth and wisdom, and so on and so on. The children of the Father will finally find the fulfillment of all their deepest longings. They will reign in the great city of the King, of their Father, together with their brothers and sisters, in wonderful joy and blessedness forever and ever. They just need to get there. And they need the seal of the Spirit to enter into their new life. But here is the thing. It's not all easy and effortless. There are agents of the enemy who are sent with one mission and one mission only: to prevent their return, to make sure that they never enter the kingdom of their Father. And the agents are many, and they work tirelessly to achieve their goal. They're smart and they're ruthless, and they use whatever strategy possible in order to snatch the seal of the Spirit away from the heirs of the great King. And they may come wearing even faces to our loved ones, our closest people. So they come with the most sophisticated and persuasive arguments, trying to convince the children of the great Lord that this message is not true, that there is no great King who is their loving Father, that there is no such kingdom where everything is good. They promise that whatever the children of the King want now, it will be given to them. Be it power or wealth or pleasures, everything will be yours. Everything will be theirs. Just listen to us and forget about the seal. Throw it away. They try to convince the beloved of the Father that they don't actually need this seal to enter the kingdom. They tell them that there are many paths that lead to the kingdom of the Father. Everyone can pick and choose whatever they please. And these agents, they have succeeded with many. Many have given up the wonderful future in exchange to lies and things that don't last and don't satisfy. And to stop us, the evil agents wouldn't hesitate even to murder, but they're restrained. The King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, has provided a protection for his children. Hidden from their eyes, there is someone, actually not just one, but three, who always stand with them as their guardians, who surround them like an unbreachable iron wall, protecting them like a shield, enclosing them like a loving parent, filling their hearts with longings to make it to their Father's great city, imbuing them with courage and desire for what is true and good and beautiful, quietly whispering in their ear, "You are my dear child. I will protect you. Nothing will separate you from me. Come home, I'm waiting." And besides, the King of Kings has given us his letter, his book, where he reveals all the truth. And this book is like a light shining in darkness, And whoever reads this book is made wise and can see through all the deceptions of the king's enemies. And thus no one can harm the king's children. It is left up to them to decide what to do with the father's invitation, to accept it or to reject it. You see, the fight for eternal life is fought in their hearts. Some win and enter the great city, but many lose this fight. See, this is our story. And you are the children of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And He indeed desires to have you with Him. He indeed has showed His love and commitment to you by laying down His life. He indeed has given you the seal of the Spirit, that is your Christian faith. And if this is true, how much should we guard the seal of the Spirit? How much should we guard our Christian faith? And this is why Paul speaks so strongly. Fight the good fight of the faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called and about which you made a good confession in the presence of many witnesses. And we need to be clear how to think about our Christian faith. It's not about what we like. It's not about what we prefer. It's not about our spiritual needs or our spiritual wants. It's not about our emotional comfort. Whatever works for me, it is a matter of life and death, of eternal life and death. And that should define, this understanding should define our attitudes. The verb that we translate as to fight describes fight or wrestling match in competition, meaning you give your everything to hold to eternal life, all your energy, all your power, all your will. When you fight for your life, there is no place for laziness and indifference. Because if you lose, then you are lost. And just think about it. See how much we worry about guarding our life here in this age. Nothing is too great a sacrifice if that helps us to save our lives, right? But then how much more should we be devoted to not losing the eternal life in the wonderful kingdom of our Father who is in heaven? And the agents of the enemy will do whatever they can to steal your faith from you. They will lie, and they will tempt you, and they will try to distract you. They will try everything and anything. And therefore, we need to be as disciplined as we possibly can, using all the armor of God and all the weapons of the Holy Spirit. We need to immerse ourselves in the Word of God, reading and studying and meditating upon it. We need to feed our faith, our soul, with the most holy meal that Jesus provides for us. We need to support and strengthen one another in our Christian fellowship, praying for one another and for our loved ones without ceasing. We need to commit to this. So Paul says, I charge you in the presence of God, who gives life to all things, and of Christ Jesus, to keep the commandment unstained and free from reproach until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ. I charge you to keep the commandment unstained and free. So, we may wonder what is meant by the commandment. The consensus among theologians is that Paul is referring to the entire message of Jesus, to everything that Jesus commanded us, the entire gospel. And what Paul is charging us is to keep and guard the gospel message so that it is unstained until the appearing of Jesus. And see, there is today one of these sticky lies which these days is repeated by the agents of the enemy again and again. There is no need to worry about pure and sound teaching of the gospel. No need to worry. Otherwise put, don't worry about false teachings. It's not a big deal. As long as we can all be friendly, that's what matters. No, no, no. Please don't let the agents of the enemy to deceive you into believing that false teachings do no harm or that all paths lead to the Father's city. If we believe these lies, then we make our God a liar, because there is no other way but Jesus the Christ. And there is no other entering the Father's great city but with the seal of the Spirit, the true faith created by the proclamation of pure and sound gospel. And every false teaching is like a wrong turn on your road, like an obstacle on your journey home. And this is why we need to fight the good fight of faith, giving to it all that we have. This week, 25th of June, we celebrate 490th birthday of Lutheran Church, the day of the proclamation of the Augsburg Confession. And our forefathers understood well that there is no room for compromises when it comes to the truth of the gospel and the matters of eternal life. They cherish the truth of the gospel more than their lives. Thus, 490 years ago, on 25th of June, a group of influential lay leaders who had heard and embraced the pure teaching of the gospel, that we are saved by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone, as revealed to us in the Holy Scriptures alone, they stood before the Emperor Charles V and confessed that the Emperor can take their lives if he wishes, but they will not deny their faith. They guarded the seal of the Spirit, their faith, as the greatest of treasures. And you, dear brothers and sisters, you are heirs in the same church that was born out of this brave confession. And the same Spirit who gave courage to our forefathers, who made Paul the apostle, the fearless confessor, the same Spirit dwells in you to help you and to guide you. When Paul wrote this letter to Timothy, when he reflected on God's incredible grace given to us unworthy and ungrateful, when he rejoiced in the gift of saving faith, he couldn't but become overwhelmed and exclaim with joy and excitement, as he did in his other letters as well. This God, this our Father, He who is a blessed and only sovereign, the King of kings and the Lord of lords, who alone has immortality, who dwells in unapproachable light, whom no one has ever seen or can see, To him be honor and eternal dominion. Amen. And yes, we should rejoice and exclaim with Paul, for this King of Kings is your God. He is your Lord. And he wants you to know him as your Father and as your brother, Jesus Christ. And he has prepared the kingdom and the great city for you. He has sealed you with the seal of the Spirit that will let you in. And he himself guards and protects you so that you do not lose your faith. So, brothers and sisters, fight the good fight of faith with all you've got. For your Father, the King of Kings, he is waiting for you. Amen. And the peace of God, which surpasses all our understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us sing to the Lord.
Given us, ourselves, our time, and our possessions, as signs of your goodness and symbols of our love, accept them for the sake of Jesus Christ, who offered himself for us.
Amen.
Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near to the Lord's throne of grace and pray as he has commanded us, trusting in the Lord to hear the prayers of his people and answer our petitions according to his mercy.
O most merciful God, Lord of heaven and earth, we pray you to so rule and govern your church and all her pastors and ministers, that she may be preserved in the pure doctrine of your saving word, defended against all adversity and protected from all adversaries, that thereby faith may be strengthened and love increased in us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Grant health, wisdom, and integrity to all in authority over us,
Endow them with your spirit and with respect for your word, that they would serve you your good pleasure for the maintenance of righteousness and the punishment of wickedness, so that we all may lead a quiet and peaceful life in all godliness and honesty. According to your gracious will, turn the hearts of our enemies and make them to walk with us in humility and peace. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for our congregations as we plan to resume our services. Guide us with your Holy Spirit and grant us your wisdom and discernment, so that by your grace we can gather again to receive your most precious gifts and to proclaim your salvation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Grant to those in trouble, want, sickness, anguish of labor, peril of death, or any other adversity, the helpful spirit of your grace for healing, strength, comfort, and relief. Bless especially those who suffer for the sake of your name and for the sake of your word. Hear us especially in behalf of Bob and Pat Taplin in all their afflictions, and on behalf of all our brothers and sisters and our loved ones, whom we name now in our hearts. Give them courage to stand firm in their afflictions and patience until the day of your deliverance. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Preserve us from pestilence and every evil. Give to us favorable weather and cause the fruits of the earth to prosper, that we may enjoy them in due season and offer you praise and thanksgiving for all your goodness to us. Lend your blessings to all honorable vocations and honest industry, that we may serve where our skills and abilities may be of good use. Bless the arts and music, that we may please you and be encouraged by all that is good, right, true, and beautiful. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Give to all husbands and wives grace to live together in love and faithfulness. Bless the homes and families of your people, that they may be places where your name is honored and love is nurtured. Give your special grace to the widow, the orphan, all mothers with child, the aged, and the infirm, that we may grant them comfort, aid, and protection. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
All these things for which you would have asked of you, we pray you to grant us, for the sake of the bitter sufferings and death of Jesus Christ, our Lord, through whom we are bold to call you Father, and in whose name we pray, trusting in your mercy, and confident that you will give answers to our prayers, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and grant you peace.
Amen.
Amen.